One of the things we've worked on for the last year is we learned that the youngest commander who has been indicted by the International Criminal Court, Dominique Ongwen, was also a child who was abducted at the age of 10. So Dominique was someone who is both a victim. You know, he went through the same brutal processes of indoctrination and being forced to kill as someone like Alice. And yet Dominique never escaped or was never released, and he was never rescued by anyone. And he was clever. He knew how to survive, and he knew how to manipulate the senior commanders to a point where he began to get promotions. And he rose in the rebel ranks over the last 18 years he's been with them to now being in this very senior command position. You only rise through the ranks in the LRA if you kill a lot of people. And Dominique has a lot of blood on his hands. But as researchers, we were very interested in this dilemma of when do you cross from being a victim to becoming a perpetrator? And it's an important question for justice advocates because on the one hand, they are arguing that children and youth should be protected and that none should be prosecuted for the crimes that they committed. And on the other hand, they want to prosecute those who abduct and enslave children. Dominique's both. So we spent almost a year looking and speaking to people who knew Dominique, either some of his former wives or people who had fought alongside him, his family, piecing together a biography of Dominique to try and understand how he got from child soldier to war criminal, and trying to resolve what would really be the best justice mechanism for someone like Dominique. It's also an important question because Dominique is not singular. There are many, many others like him. In fact, I would even argue that there are generations of African youth growing up in situations of chronic crisis who have known nothing but the law of the gun. They've been socialized into rebel movements, born, some of them, into rebel movements, knowing only violence as a political narrative, not ever having any contact or benefit from a formal state. Is that solely their responsibility? Should they solely be individually accountable for what's happened to them? Or are there a wider set of questions about how the state failed them, how the international community failed them, that need to be examined? So I think that they're an important group to identify within a wider discussion on transitional justice or justice after mass atrocity and conflict, because blindly prosecuting them without looking at the wider context in which they committed these crimes would do a great injustice, I think, not just to them, but to their communities.